The following program is produced by the Living Church of God.
Would you recognize a true Christian if you saw one? Do you realize that most professing Christians are deceived? They literally don't know much at all about what the Bible says. They don't know the true God. They don't know the true Christ. They couldn't explain the Bible if they had to. Most of them could not even name the four Gospels. Therefore, God can't give them protection during the coming great tribulation. They're not doing what He says. They're not obeying Him. They don't even understand what He says. What should you do? What action should you take in the years ahead? Stay tuned.
Tomorrow's World. The Living Church of God presents Dr. Roderick C. Meredith, Richard Ames, bringing you the good news of your future in tomorrow's world. This week, Dr. Roderick C. Meredith asks, "What is a true Christian?" Part 2. Now, Dr. Roderick C. Meredith.
My friends, as I proved to you last week, the vast majority of humanity is deceived. They don't know the true God. They don't know the true Jesus Christ. Of course, a deceived person doesn't know that he's deceived, does he? If you understand, then you aren't deceived. But he may not even be willing to listen to someone who would tell him the truth, this deceived person. Are you like that? Notice what Jesus Christ said. I ask you to go get your Bible, my friends, in these programs. Don't believe me. You believe what you read in the pages of your own Bible. As we really get into the Bible, you're going to understand things you may never have understood before, because mainstream Christianity, so-called, does not teach these things. Notice in Matthew chapter 15, the teaching of Jesus Christ, here's what Jesus said. His disciples came and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees were offended when they heard this saying?" Well, Jesus kind of shook things up too, didn't he? The religious leaders did not always like what Christ taught. In fact, they usually didn't like it. And he answered and said, "Every plant which my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind leaders of the blind." These, that is the religious leaders, were blind leaders of the blind. "And if the blind leads the blind," Jesus said, "both will fall into a ditch." Both of them, those who lead and those who follow. Once again, I want you to understand what this is all about. I want you to turn to 2 Corinthians 11 and verse 4. "For if he who comes preaches another Jesus," Paul says, talking about Jesus, yes, mentioning the name Jesus, "but another Jesus, not the real Jesus of the Bible, whom we have not preached, or if you receive a different spirit, a different approach, a different attitude, which we have not received, or a different gospel, which you have not accepted," yes, there are false gospels, "you may well put up with it." A lot of people just put up with whatever is around. False Christianity, false conversion. Think about it. These things happen, and we've got to beware. We have got to be willing, as God tells us back in Luke 4 and verse 4, Jesus said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God." Every word of God. And you've got to learn to study this word, to really understand it, to think about it, to build it into your mind. You don't need to be nicey-nice. The God of creation is not nicey-nice. But you need to understand the plan and purpose, the real plan and purpose of your Creator. And it's not just to get sentimental about the person of Jesus Christ or the name of Jesus Christ. It's a matter of a way of life. It's a matter of being changed to build and to let God build within you the very character He has so you can live throughout all eternity. Let's turn back to Luke 6 and verse 46. Here's what Jesus said, "But why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say?" Well, yes, people call Jesus Lord. How good it is to know the Lord this morning, the preacher used to say on Sunday morning. But that preacher didn't know the Lord. He had no understanding of God's will, God's plan, or God's commandments. But he talked about knowing the Lord and used the name Jesus Christ. You don't dare call Christ Lord, or shouldn't, unless you do what He says. And that most people do not want to do and most people do not understand. Let's turn now to Matthew, if you would. Matthew chapter 19. Let's go to Matthew chapter 19 and more of the teaching of Jesus Christ. This teaching was not nailed to the cross. It was not done away, as I explained last time. And I'll explain again today. What Christ said stands forever. These are the words of life. Matthew 19, verse 16. Now behold, one came and said to him, "Good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?" What's the way to salvation? People talk about, well, you need to be saved. Saved from what? What do you be saved from? Well, you're saved from eternal death. Because God tells you back in Romans 6 and 23, the wages of sin is death. That's the reward for sin, eternal death in the lake of fire. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The rest of that scripture continues. You're saved from eternal death. You're saved from being cut off from God and being dead forever. And, of course, the Bible describes the lake of fire as the instrument that does that. So how do you get eternal life? He said to him, now does Jesus know? You say, well, Jesus didn't know about Christianity because the cross hadn't come yet. Yeah, what a joke. Doesn't Christ know what Christianity is? Here is the Son of God telling us what to do. Don't let somebody else mess your minds up with some other crazy explanation. Here is the Son of God speaking. Why do you call me good? There's no good but one, that is God. But if you want to enter into life, here it is, keep the commandments. That's what Jesus said. He said that. Is that clear? Keep the commandments. And this young man asked, which? I don't think he should have had any problem. He was a young Jew, but perhaps he wanted to know. And then Jesus began to explain some of the Ten Commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness, and so on. He began to explain some of the Ten Commandments. As we found last time in James the second chapter, if you break one point of the law, you break them all. And certainly Jesus understood that as the very Son of God and inspired James to write that later. Yes, the Ten Commandments are the spiritual law of God. They're like the law of gravity. The law of gravity automatically pulls this Bible down. I don't have to slap it down. I just drop it. It just goes down. It's an automatic, moving, living law. The Ten Commandments is an automatic, moving, living law. It automatically works. If you kill someone, God doesn't have to immediately punish you in that sense to make something bad. He will punish you later. He will. But it automatically causes hurt in your character that will cause you to do other things later, including that you'll be terribly sorry for and suffer for. It will hurt then make that man's life come to an end, or that woman. And if others find out, which they nearly always do, then your family, your friends, your loved ones are ashamed and hurt and disgruntled and torn up. And that family's torn up, and society comes after you, and what are you going to do? You're in trouble with man and God. You've broken a living, moving principle. That's what the Ten Commandments are. Christianity involves Christ living His life in you, and He kept the Ten Commandments. He set us an example that we should follow in His steps. Notice back in Galatians now, the book of Galatians, chapter 2 and verse 20. I often quote this from the King James, because that's the way I first memorized it. But it says in Galatians 2:20, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. That's the principle right here. All translations have it the same. Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live with the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me. You live not by your human faith in Christ, but Christ's faith in you. The faith of the Son of God. He puts that faith in you through the Holy Spirit, where God becomes real to you. And you know God, and you're aware of God as a reality. And you pray to God, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting, as Paul says. Praying to God every day, two or three times on your knees. Throughout the day, in a spirit of prayer, knowing God is real. You're here. He's there. You're His servant. You're walking with God, talking with God, communing God. And you're a servant of the living God. And you try to let God guide every single phase and facet of your life. You yield to God. You pray for Christ to live His life in you. In the way you treat your wife, in the way you treat your husband, and the way you treat your children, and the way you treat your neighbors, the way you treat your friends, the way you treat your coworkers, wherever you work, the way you treat everyone else. You love every human being made in the image of God, because all of them are made in the image of God. They may have a different background, a different education. They may be of a different race. They may even have a different religion. God is not trying to save the world now, and He isn't calling everyone now. Otherwise, they would be called. He's not doing that yet, but He's going to in His time. Even those who were killing Christ, He loved. He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Father, they don't get it. They don't understand. They don't realize I'm the Son of God. They don't realize that my teaching is the teaching of life. That's the way it is, my friends. We've got to love every human being, because every human being is made in the image of Almighty God. And we've got to love God with all our heart and strength and mind, and walk with Him, talk with Him, commune with Him, pray with Him, actively give our lives into His hand, and truly love our neighbors with the help of God, because Christ will live within us through the Holy Spirit, the power of the precious Holy Spirit, the very nature, the very character of God. He comes within you. He will come within me if we yield to Him and surrender to Him in the right way. Not nicey-nice, but genuinely give our lives to God. He will then live within us through the Holy Spirit. And then we can be real Christians at that point. At this point, I urge you, please write or call today for a free audio tape of this very topic. What is a true Christian? This is a special tape. It will go way beyond what so many people will tell you about just giving your heart to the Lord. This tape contains powerful truths which you need to know. So call or write today and request your free audio tape. This tape is absolutely free. Your free audio tape, What is a True Christian?
This informative audio tape is yours absolutely free. No cost, no obligation. If you call this toll-free number, 1-800-934-5579. That's 1-800-934-5579. Or send your request to Tomorrow's World, P.O. Box 501-304, San Diego, California, 92150. With this offer, you will also receive your free subscription to Tomorrow's World magazine, full of timely articles and unique insight on today's important issues. No cost, no obligation to you. Call today.
Now back to our topic, what is a true Christian? We were in Galatians 2 and verse 20, for those of you who may have tuned in late. Here's where the Apostle Paul said, "I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, not the old self, but Christ lives in me." That's the key to a true Christian. "And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me." Realize that Christ is the one who will enable you to be all that you're meant to be. He will enable you to have the love, the joy, the peace, the faith, the wisdom, and the power to grow spiritually, to overcome. You will have a better life because you will have greater understanding. You will have greater wisdom. You'll have a faith and a courage because you'll know that your hand is in God's hand and you're walking with God and God will be with you. Therefore, we know the overcomers are going to inherit the kingdom of God. The overcomers, and Christ in you, will help you overcome yourself. He will help you overcome the world. He will help you through His Spirit overcome Satan the devil. He is alive. Notice back in Hebrews 13, and let's begin reading here in verse 7. "Remember those who rule over you," the apostle wrote. He's talking to, of course, the Hebrews, the original Christians, who have spoken the word of God to you. These people have been around a long time. And though many of them had heard Christ, and certainly many of them had heard the original apostles, they knew what was taught. "They've spoken to you the word of God, whose faith follow." Don't change into some different faith where you just believe on Christ and go do your thing. "Remember what they taught," he says, "considering the outcome of their conduct. Jesus Christ is the same." Christ has not changed. Christ does not change His basic approach. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he goes on and says, "Do not be carried about with various and strange doctrines." He knew strange doctrines and teachings would come along. Don't change. Stay with the truth. The apostles taught us all the way through the New Testament. We have to understand that. Jesus Christ is the same. Christ obeyed the Ten Commandments. As I said, He set us that example. John 15, verse 10. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in His love. The commandments of Christ are simply, as we saw in the last program, expounding, magnifying the commandments of God. They're not some new commandments. He said, you're not only not to kill, you're not even to hate your neighbor. You're not only not to commit adultery, you're not even to look on a woman to lust after her. He made the commandments all the more binding. He didn't give some new commandments knocking His Father's law on the head. No way did Jesus Christ do that. So let's understand, we are to keep the commandments of God. And of course, Christ is God. He said, I and the Father are one. You remember that? So He didn't change God's way all around at all. Notice chapter 14 now, and I'm going to be again reading here in verse 15. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments, these expositions, the magnifications He gave of the Father's commandments, and I will pray the Father, and He will give you another helper, that He may abide with you. You see, this helper will help God abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it does not see Him or know Him, but you know Him, for He dwells with you. He dwelt with the apostles, but He was not yet in them. That's why Peter denied Christ three times there at the end of Jesus' life. But of course, a few weeks later on the day of Pentecost, Peter preached powerfully, and then he risked his life again and again, standing up for Christ even when they were threatening him with death. His life was changed once the Holy Spirit came. Notice now in verse 23, Jesus answered and said, if anyone loves me, notice, he will keep my word. And my Father will love him, and we, God the Son and God the Father, we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words. And the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. Again, Christ didn't come with some brand new teaching. He simply magnified the Father's teaching and made it holy. He helped us understand the spirit of the law, as the whole New Testament tells us. But he says, if you love Christ, you will keep his word. You will do what he says. You won't just talk about him and say how good it is to know the Lord. You will do what he says. You see, true Christianity is not just something on Sunday. True Christianity is not just joining a church. It is not something you put over in the corner of your life. It is something that involves giving your life to God all day long, where Christ actually lives in you, guiding, inspiring, and motivating you in every phase and facet of your being, where you exercise, if you take walks every day or go to a gym, you keep in shape, not so you can be big and strong and win the Mr. America or Mrs. America contest or something, which is not necessarily evil, although that could be a thing of vanity, of course. I worked out a lot back when I was 12, 16 years old, through those years of early teens and so on. I wanted to be big and strong. I wanted to be 6'3" and 220 pounds. I never quite made it. Too bad for me, because my father and mother were not like that. And I would stand as a 13-year-old in front of the mirror, you know, and puff up, and then later I'd pinch my teenage pimples and so on, and, you know, trying to be big and strong. Why? Because of vanity. That's why. Just a kid. Just had that vanity. But now I take walks every day, and sometimes I do some push-ups or some light dumbbells. Why? So I can be big and strong? No, folks, it's too late for me. I can't be big and strong in that way and win the Mr. America contest. Sincerely, I try to exercise every day so I can feel better, live longer, and so I can serve you and serve in this work of God longer because it is my life. That's why I'm here. I want to be around and continue this. In order to be a better servant of the living God, I exercise, I try to be careful of what I eat, I try to do the right things. mostly not for vanity. You say, do you have any vanity? Of course I do. Every human being does. But we try to get rid of more and more of it every year we live and grow in grace and in knowledge. So we exercise, we try to eat the right foods and do those things, not for vanity if you're a real Christian, but to serve God, to honor Him, to glorify God in your body, as the Apostle Paul expressed it back in 1 Corinthians. You try to do this and do that through your whole life, whatever it is. You try to be a success to honor God so you can have a better life with your family. Be a better example to your neighbors. Help others more. Serve the church of God and the work of God more. Give more. Have more to give. You're doing it not to get, but to give if you're a real Christian. It is Christ's life. He will live His life within every phase and facet of your being through the Holy Spirit if you truly surrender your heart and mind and life to Him. And that's what you've got to do. That's what I've got to do. That's what we've all got to do through the help of the Spirit of God. Let's turn now to Colossians chapter 3, if you would, and beginning in verse 1. Paul writes, if then you were raised with Christ, obviously raised from the baptismal grave, when you're truly baptized as an adult, when you understand what to repent of and what Christianity is all about, then you're baptized. You're immersed in the water. You're brought down into a watery grave, and then you're raised up. If you were raised with Christ, he says, seek. Go with all your heart. Go for it. Seek those things which are above. Have your mind on God. Have your mind on the kingdom of God, the reward, the opportunity to serve. And God's government on this earth will last forever. Keep your mind on those things which are above, where Christ is sitting. He is there at the Father's right hand. Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth, for you died. You see, in baptism, in real conversion, the old self died. And you should have died, but most people don't even understand that. You should have been baptized after a profound change, a profound repentance as an adult, if you have been truly converted. And then, if that occurred, you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God, when Christ, who is our life, what a beautiful expression, when Christ, who is our life, we don't have any other life apart from Christ if we're a true Christian. We've given every phase of our lives to Christ. We've given our business life, we've given our exercise, our recreational life, our sex life, our marriage relationship. Frankly, every phase and facet of our being is given to Christ. We want to honor Christ as a married couple. We want to honor Christ as parents. We want to honor Christ as ministers, as brethren, as servants of the living God in everything we think and everything we say and everything we do. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. Revelation chapter 12, if you skim over the earlier verses here, he's talking about the true church of God that has, at the end of this age, to flee to a place of safety. And he describes that, how in verse 13, the dragon or the devil persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child, and the woman was given two wings of a great eagle to fly into the wilderness into her place. A place of safety for the true church of God. And some are left behind, even of the true church. And so in verse 17, it says the dragon was enraged with the woman. Those who are not watching and praying and serving are not taken to a place of safety. Nevertheless, they are part of the true church. And the devil comes after them. And he went to make war with the rest of her offspring, of the true church of God, the little flock. And who are they? Who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Yes, my friends, wherever God's church is described in the Bible, it is the church that keeps God's commandments. Not the church that has a dead faith, but the church that has a living faith. Notice chapter 14 now and verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints. Not some people in white robes off somewhere, but just normal Christians, but real Christians, the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God, not some new commandments of Jesus, although they keep those too, but for the sake of argument, he's talking about the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus, not just our human faith in Jesus, but again, the faith of Jesus, where we believe God. We have living faith. Therefore, we'll be willing to do what God says, knowing He'll back up His word. He will make it turn out right. Notice at the very end, then, of the book of Revelation, the very last chapter of your Bible, does God change things around? at the very end? No, he does not. Notice Revelation 22, Revelation chapter 22 and verse 14. Blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates into the city. They may be in the holy city of God. Yes, my friends, we've got to live that way of life with all of our being. Our entire society is going down the tubes. And when the great tribulation, which is just ahead of us, comes, you really need this kind of Christianity, the kind of Christianity where Christ lives his life in you. You let him become a Christian in you, real Christianity. And with the power of the living Christ within you, you will have understanding you have never had before. You will have a deep peace of mind that you never had before. And you will have God's protection in the years ahead. Terrible times, a great tribulation coming, our whole society blowing up. And you will have God's help and God's mercy in giving you eternal life in the kingdom of God if you walk that way and live that way, the way of Christ living within you. And by the way, if any of you would like to learn more about what's behind this work and this program, or if you would like to counsel with some of our leaders about acting on the truth, doing something about this, then write or call, write us today, or call the toll-free number given on the screen. Give the operator your telephone number and address very slowly and clearly. Then our minister or representative will call up and set an appointment at your convenience. He will not just knock on your door. You will not be pressured to do anything or join anything, but you will have an opportunity to discuss your Bible questions and related matters with the true servant of God. Again, be sure to write or call for this free audio tape, this powerful tape, What is a True Christian? Your eternity is at stake. You need this tape, my friends, yet it will be sent absolutely free upon your request. So call or write before you forget it and request your free copy of the audio tape, What is a True Christian?
This informative audio tape is yours absolutely free. No cost, no obligation. If you call this toll-free number, 1-800-934-5579. That's 1-800-934-5579. Or send your request to Tomorrow's World, P.O. Box 501-304, San Diego, California, 92150. With this offer, you will also receive your free subscription to Tomorrow's World magazine, full of timely articles and unique insights on today's important issues. No cost, no obligation to you. Call today.
Be sure to tune in every week at the same time to Tomorrow's World program. Richard Ames and I will open your eyes to prophetic events and biblical truths you have never understood before. So take time to tune in every week. See you right here next week.
The informative audio cassette offered on this program is yours absolutely free if you call this toll-free number, 1-800-934-5579. Or send your request to Tomorrow's World, P.O. Box 501-304, San Diego, California, 92150. Be sure to visit our webpage at www.tomorrowsworld.org. The preceding program was produced by the Living Church of God.